Retro.
No.
Hey, you scruffy nerf herders. This is Catherine Tabor, Mission Veo from Knights of the Old Republic, and you're listening to Jay and Dennis on Podcast Stardust. Aren't you lucky?
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And in this episode, we're going to go back to a comic from 2017 with a look at Marvel's Cassian and K-2SO. But first, Jay can remind everybody where they can find all of our social media outlets around the internet.
Absolutely. My memory stores are hopefully operating at 100%. And we are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right. The dish is aligned. The signal is boosted to maximum output. The shield is down. We are now broadcasting to the galaxy. This is our discussion of Cassian and K-2SO. Again, this was a comic that originally came out in 2017 as a tie-in to Rogue One. It was written by Dwayne Swierczynski, and art was by Fernando Blanco, and it was colored by Marcelo Maiolo. And this really, at its core, is the story about how Cassian, Andor, and K-2SO met, and how Cassian ended up getting this reprogrammed Imperial droid into his service. What did you think about this one-shot overall, Jay?
I'm so glad that you suggested that we do this, because it's one of those things that's been on my bucket list to read, but, you know, just with everything else, and of course we've been getting all the High Republic stuff, and then all these wonderful books this summer, and everything like that. I mean, yes, it's been since 2017, so I really don't have a good excuse, but I'm glad that we did this, and it was a heck of a lot of fun. I mean, I really enjoyed the way that Cassian almost was breaking the fourth wall, in a way, by speaking throughout this comic. And I just appreciated how it was laid out, and it was lighthearted. It was fun. I told my husband, I'm like, this is adorable. It's an adorable little story. And I just have always treasured that relationship between K2 and Cassian. And now I know how it started.
Right. Yeah. And of course we're doing this because we're getting the Andor series right now. And of course this comic takes place well after season one.
Cause of course,
Cassian is well ingrained in the rebellion at this point. He makes explicit references to the rebellion, and he doesn't really know anything about the rebellion at where we are in Andor and stuff like that. But it just seemed like a good time to cover this. And like you said, I too enjoy these characters and the relationship they had. And of course, all the fun little lines that K-2SO got over the course of Rogue One. And I couldn't help but have all of, Cassian's lines and, you know, Diego Luna's voice in my head, and then K-2SO, you know, Alan Tudyk, when I read this. And so, this was a fun little read. And the whole setup for this is that Cassian is trying to get some new Imperial protocols so they can infiltrate Imperial systems, monitor Imperial communications. And he's going to go to this planet of Weekako. And he's got these two purple-skinned alien twins, Curtis and Rizmore, with him. They've got, like I said, purple skin, yellow hair, and purple skin, yellow eyes, and purple hair. And they don't actually talk much. They communicate with each other through scent. They change the chemical compounds in the air around them, and that's how they primarily talk. So it's a really fun aspect of this comic where throughout he's like talking to them. They don't directly answer him, but they've clearly talked to each other because he smells things that they've been talking. What did you think about these twins?
I thought it was fascinating. And so afterwards, I had to get on Wikipedia and see what I could find. And at first I couldn't find anything. So I just went back to Google, and I was Googling things like Star Wars aliens that speak through pheromones. And so I actually ended up finding the species, and they're called Zeltrons. So it's just, it says
Zeltron are actually something different.
Sentient species. But no, they're not the same thing, because it says they have purple hair color, same skin color?
Yeah, Zeltrons were originated in the original Marvel series, and they've got a slightly different background, and they do have pheromones, but that's not their primary mode of communication. There was actually one in the Star Wars Legacy comic that went around with Cade Skywalker.
Interesting. Okay. Because yeah, in the credits, it does say it lists this comic as a reference for, like, underneath their notes and references, like the sources and stuff like that, or appearances.
Yeah, but they're never labeled Zeltrons in this at all. So that's a, you know, that's a conclusion that someone must have leapt to, because these are a different species.
Fair enough, because Wikipedia is very similar to Wikipedia in that other people get to edit it. So
yeah,
fair enough. Yeah. Yes.
Right. And, you know, it's funny, they don't speak till the very end of the comic, and we'll get to that in a bit. But I did enjoy those two because, you know, Cassian would say something like, you know, when they finally get to later into the mission and they find the ship, and then they're trying to get some information out of it. And these two, Curtis and Rizmore, are legendary for ferreting out elusive Imperial intel, and they're running out of time. So he's like, hey, you two almost done? Did you find anything yet? And he's like, I'm not even sure what they said, but that smelled like they were telling me to shut up. So, yes. As you pointed out earlier in the discussion, it's not, I mean, we're getting, you know, Cassian is retelling the story, essentially, mm-hmm, what it comes down to. But the lines that he delivers and what he's imagining these two are saying throughout the comic is pretty humorous.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And I was giggling. And we were talking a little bit about this before we had started. And I didn't have enough time to actually read the comic. Mm-hmm. So I kind of cheated and I feel bad now. But I ended up watching it on YouTube through a channel called Star Wars Audio Comic. And they actually did a really good job. You were talking about hearing Cassian's voice and K2's voice. So I didn't take time to, you know, look at the credits or who actually recorded this, but they did a really good job with the voices. And so as I was watching / listening to this, it really did kind of add to the charm of it when they were reading things like Cassian would say them, you know, as you, mm-hmm, just said, I will take that as they were telling me to shut up.
Yeah.
So it was really good.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really cleverly written. I am not familiar with any of Dwayne Swarzynski's other work, at least none of it's coming to mind, but I thought he did a good job writing a fun story and making you hear Cassian and K2SO's voice in this. Because I mean, they're like the only two other than like some random stormtroopers. And then eventually Curtis and Rizmore, one of the two of them, get some lines there at the end. But I mean, it's mainly Cassian and K2 that are doing all the talking in this.
Right.
But yeah, so they get to Wessico, and it's kind of another Jedha type of a world, and not that it necessarily has all the Force mysticism with the Guardians of the Wills or anything like that, but it has the Jedha or Batu lived in look to it, you know, with kind of like the rock structures and stuff like that, with some industrial stuff around as well. What did you think about the setting?
No, I think you hit the nail right on the head with that. And that's a great, great type of way to describe it. So I don't really have anything more to add.
Yeah. And so they're trying to find this Imperial cruiser that fell into private hands, and they sneak in through the sewers. Another great opportunity for Cassian to deliver a line about, you know, I can't tell if that's raw sewage or if you two were talking behind my back.
Awesome.
That whole scent communication thing was just brilliant, because, you know, it gave Cassian all these opportunities for these one-liners, which were fantastic. And it's just a unique thing. I mean, it's a, you know, we think of like Prince Xizor from Shadows of the Empire and how he could influence those of the opposite species to desire him by using the pheromones, and then he could also kind of influence others, you know, men as well. But you know, he wasn't directly communicating with those pheromones here. Mm-hmm. And you know, these two are having these entire conversations. And then, you know, whenever apparently they've said something, you know, you just get those dot, dot, dots in response to, it's like they've mumbled or it's just, you know, that they were talking between themselves. I'm not entirely certain what it was supposed to be, but, you know, Cassian's like, I'll take that as a no. And so, you know, he's getting through his mission, but he's not having any luck communicating with these two. So very clever aspect of this.
For sure.
But they get into the hangar and they find the cruiser, and it looks like the back of a Star Destroyer.
It does, yes.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was supposed to be that or they meant to do something else and they just put a Star Destroyer in there. But they are looking at a monitor and that they've noticed that there's a bunch of stormtroopers that are about to follow them in through the sewers. And so someone had obviously noticed them. And that's when Cassian's telling the twins to, hey, hurry this up, and they got to get out of there. And they're trying to avoid these K-series droids and a bunch of stormtroopers, except for Cassian deliberately times it and makes a little bit of noise to get the attention of one of these droids, and it happens to be K-2SO. So there's their meeting there. And so Cassian's trying to goad him into it. It's like, you know, oh, you don't need to call for backup. You know, you're a big droid and I'm just one guy. And, you know, it's, you know, Cassian or K-2SO had been saying things like, you know, you seem awfully insistent on being captured. Yes. I'm going to call for backup. And
you don't need backup.
Yeah, you don't need backup. I'm just one guy. And so Cassian does this little flip over K-2SO's, and he's looking for that kill switch, kind of like 3PO has on the back of his head. It's not there. And I thought that was a charming moment. And then, of course, the twins pop up behind him, and it's on his back, and they turn him off. Another really great aspect of this comet. So Cassian asks the twins, like, either of you know how to reprogram dynamic? I didn't think so. And so he tries to do it himself. But when he turns K-2SO back on, he tells him, like, well, I've only had 29.73% of my memory erased. I felt compelled to tell you that. And I must detain you. And if you resist, terminate your life. And so he's very courteous about this.
Very matter of fact, Jess, I'm just giving you fair warning. Indeed.
I must detain you, and if you resist, terminate your life. Got it? And so, you know, he tries to reprogram him and says, you know, your mission here is to get our ship and then take anyone out that gets in our way. And so he's like, I got it. You know, and this is after they've already shut him down and tried reprogramming him again. Well, he wakes up, and they're on the way back to the ship, and they run into some stormtroopers, and you know, the stormtrooper's like, hey, you there, what are you doing? And he says, I'm escorting these rebel spies to their ship.
Their ship.
And if you try and stop me, I'm gonna have to take you out.
Which is so great, because when K2, I mean, he's just so great at repeating things, because it just reminds me of when he says, and the whole system goes down, isn't that what you said? You know, and it's just like word for word.
Yeah.
I will take you out. You know, it's the same kind of thing.
You said it just like that. The whole system goes down. Exactly. And so, and it very matter of factly, it's, I'm escorting these two rebel spies to their ship. And if you interfere, I'm going to take you down. And so they get past those stormtroopers. And then Cassian says to K2, is like, okay, they can't get to their ship. It gets blown. So he says, you know, you have to do something. He's like, wait a minute, you said you were in charge. Now you want me to decide what to do? He's like, yes. He goes, well, in that case, I will detain you and term your life here.
Right. If necessary. Right back to protocol.
Yes, yeah, so he's falling back on this base programming here. You know, this is, it's only a one shot, and it's 27 pages. So it's a little bit longer than the average story, but it's the pacing of this comic is really, really great. And then this is where Curtis and Rizmore jump into action, and they're like, this droid has got the Imperial intel we need. Get it back to the Rebellion. They flat out tell Cassian, and then they go running off to create this distraction. And so Cassian has to take K-2SO out again, turn him off, and then cordon off his base programming, which has got the protocols they need, but he needs K-2SO not to kill him. And so, you know, this is all preceded. You know, he wakes up and he's like, you know, K2S is like, well, I'm supposed to detain you. No, wait a minute, terminate you. It's definitely one of those two things.
So great.
Yeah, again, I think Dwayne did a great job writing K2SO's dialogue here. And then eventually they find a ship, and it's taking too long for Cassian to get in. So K2 kicks down the door and is like, you could have just asked for help. And then eventually they get out of there. And we kind of get the birth of the dialogue where, you know, when they're on the U-Wing escaping from Jeddah and K2SO is taking too long programming the coordinates, you know, Cassian just jumped into light speed. And so, you know, we get a similar scene here where they're trying to leave a week ago. So, yeah, I mean, it's a pretty straightforward comic. Any other observations that you have about it?
Well, when Curtis and Rizmore were actually talking, didn't they, one of them touched Cassian on the face and the other one touched him on like his chest. So I'm wondering if it was more of like they had to be in contact with him to be able to communicate in that way. So was it actually speaking or was it talking through touch, you know, like almost like a telepathic kind of thing, like mind to mind talk?
That's an interesting observation. I mean, it was, I'm pretty sure they used a speech bubble for that communication. But, you know, that you bring it up, you know, maybe because they rely on that other sense, you know, scent is even more powerful, more important to them than it is to us, that, you know, using something tactile, you know, just their custom is if they're going to communicate that they are going to use more of their senses than just verbally putting it out there and relying on Cassian to hear them. And maybe that's why they weren't responding, because he was simply using the one sense when he talked to them. Whereas, you know, like when they were communicating, they typically would use the scent and look at each other.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, that's an interesting thought. I'd like to find out more.
Yeah, because I know one of them like touched him on the side of his face when they were speaking to him. And then the other one like touched him, I think, on his chest, if I remember correctly. So that's where my thought on that one came from. And then my other thing too with K2 is that I just think this does a really great job of kind of setting the stage for how K2 becomes a lot more self-sufficient and witty on his own, you know, in the future, because it just reminded me when they were saying, when he said, I am taking these rebel spies to their ship, when they were in Jeddah, and he said, I am imprisoning them to take them to prison because they're prisoners.
Yeah, exactly. That's a really good observation. And I think you're right, because yeah, he's had his programming like completely erased and scrambled. He was getting confused. And then he's like really allowed to develop his own little personality there. And, you know, he was telling Jin in Rogue One, you know, it's like, I'm an Imperial droid. And, you know, but then he says, you know, I'm a tactical droid. What would I know? Those type of things
right.
And so this would kind of account for a lot of those quirks.
Yeah.
That but we then see he from has- him.
Yeah, he still has that 8.3% of his memory. So he still has that little kernel of his original personality. But yet, and I mean, just him saying things like, curious, you seem to rely on empty threats instead of a strong bargaining position. Like he's very blunt, you know, and he's still very blunt, you know, as far as him telling Cassian about Jin having the blaster and, you know, do you want to know the probability of her using it on you? You know, he's just, and so I think that this comic just does a great job of preserving that, but yet setting up that idea of this is where it comes from. So yeah, very, very good.
Yeah. I was hoping they were going to do a follow-up to this comic. They never did, but you know, that ship that they stole, as it looked familiar, but I couldn't find any trace of what it was supposed to be.
Interesting. Well, it kind of reminded me in the shape of a U-Wing, but I know it's not a U-Wing.
Right. Yeah. No, I mean, it's, you know, maybe it's made by the same manufacturer and, you know, just a different model of a ship that they would have put together. But I was hoping to see, you know, see more of these two. Now, granted, now we got an entire Andor series and we're going to be getting all kinds of stories about Andor going forward. I don't know how many opportunities we're going to get for stories with Cassian and K2SO, which is what I'd really love to see next season. But if they're not going to do that, then I hope they would get around at some point, especially if this series is successful, to writing more of these adventures with Cassian and K2. Because going forward after this season, you know, we have 1 year, 5 years before Rogue One, and then they're giving us like a few days every year, year by year, until we get to Rogue One. Well, that's plenty of room.
Oh, yeah.
Put in more Cassian and K2. Even if they never want to give us a live action retelling of how these two met, just giving us the opportunity to see them do stuff again together and get more of this type of dialogue would be fantastic.
Oh, for sure. Yes. I would actually love to see this comic be brought to life because I want to see the twins in a live action series. I think that would be really cool.
Well, even if they don't do that, if next season we got these two in that episode, whatever it is, I'd settle for that. I mean, the thing is that I don't know that that's possible given the framework that they just did in this comic, which was these two were recommended to me after I suggested this mission to General Draven. So this is his first time working with them, but who's to say they couldn't show up in an episode with K-2SO and Cassian going forward?
Right. Right. So true. Yeah. I think there's a lot of room there for some creative exploration.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not a long conversation because it's, one-shot comic and there's not a ton of dialogue in it. And so we got through all the events here, but you have any other final thoughts before we wrap this up?
No, I think we hit it all. Just a really enjoyable comic. I'm glad we did it.
All right. Okay. Well, I've enjoyed this too. We'll have to find some of these other miniseries that have come up along the way. They're easier to digest once they're done and out there. And it's fun to kind of go back and look at a lot of these things. So look out for that in the future. Mm-hmm. But with that, I'd like to thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust and our discussion of Cassian and K-2SO. We hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, we hope you consider subscribing to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice. I'd like to also remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over on RetroZap.com, which is home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU, DC, Dune, the Animaniacs, collecting, and a whole lot more. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you do use for your podcast, especially if that is Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes over on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, what are our social media contacts one more time?
All right. So we are found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can check out our Pinterest boards. We have tons of them over there. And we also have a YouTube channel. So hit us up over there, like and subscribe. You can find all of our past episodes as well as some unboxing videos there. And we do have a Discord room over on the RetroZap Discord server where you can join in on some real-time chatter. And if you want to do that, just go to our show page and click on our community tab and you are there. And we also have a TeePublic store where you can check out 7 different show logo designs on everything from t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, all kinds of swag, including magnets and stickers and even baby onesies. So head over to teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust.
All right. Well, before we wrap this up, did you want to give everybody an update on cosplay?
Oh, I would love to. As usual, you can catch me at j.snipscosplay on my Instagram. And I am going to be appearing a couple of times this month. And I'm super excited about that, close to my hometown here at 2 different events. I will be Ahsoka at 1 and the Fourth Sister, where I will be debuting that cosplay. Been very hard at work over there. So check out my stories and my posts to find out all the progress that I've been doing on that, as well as featuring some other cosplayers and store owners and artists and the like. So again, that is j.snipscosplay.
All right, that'll do it for episode 474 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the force be with you.